Lovely to see you. I wasn't expecting that even this crowd on a bank holiday weekend before all the schools go back and everything else like that. But it's lovely to see you. And if you're watching online, the same. And even those who have gone off for the weekend, you may be tuning in. And we're all very welcome. Thank you for coming this morning. Just a few announcements. The next time the church will meet is on Wednesday evening. And that's a report back night at 8 o'clock. And Philip Saunders will be leading that and telling about what he did over his month in Africa. And also someone else who was away for a month. And welcome back to Jake. Arrived in just sometime late last night, I think it was. You're very welcome back as well. So I know there's going to be some good news on Wednesday evening. So if you don't want to miss that, you need to turn up there at 8 o'clock. Next Sunday, as you can see up on the wall behind me, or it was up there earlier, Pastor or Dr. Alan Wilson will be the speaker morning and evening, and the evening is a communion service then. I hope to be on leave for a while, Barbara, myself, and if anybody needs help, you contact Ralph or contact Simon, and they can either help you or bring Clifford Morrison in, who will be also helping and standby as well. So, thank you for coming. We're going to read the scriptures. Our theme this morning is thankfulness. It's praise unto God. I don't know about you, but I think it's been a busy enough summer. Not enough, but busy summer. We've been doing a lot of things, and I know a lot of you were exhausted after the Holiday Bible Club. Everybody seemed to just pull out the stops and get right in there. And we've lost voices. We've done all sorts of things. And it's just good to stop and thank the Lord. And so we're going to look at some things this morning. Reasons to be thankful. Reasons to praise. Reasons to worship. And as we do that, I'm going to start by taking us back into the Old Testament. Psalm 18, just the first three verses. And then we're going to be led in a couple of songs which are praise worthy, praise unto the Lord. There's quite an introduction to Psalm 18. And it says, to the choirmaster, a psalm of David, the servant of the Lord, who addressed the words of this song to the Lord on the day when the Lord delivered him from the hand of all his enemies and from the hand of Saul. He said, I love you, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised, and I am saved from my enemies. Let's have those two songs of worship. Thank you.
turn to you.
Song.
Thanks, folks. You know, we've been reading Psalms, and we're coming out of Psalm 142, Psalm 142. And we're going to make this the basis of our prayer as we pray for others. It's lovely to see, I'm going to say it very carefully, I'm a more mature person and a very, very, very young person here today. Ted, it's lovely to see you back again. And Samuel is in there somewhere in the middle, just a couple of weeks old. So you're both very welcome indeed. Psalm 142. Again, another song of David. With my voice I cry out to the Lord. With my voice I plead for mercy to the Lord. I pour out my complaint before him. I tell my trouble before him. When my spirit faints within me, you know my way. In the path where I walk, they have hidden a trap for me. Look to the right and see. There's none who takes notice of me. No refuge remains to me. No one cares for my soul. I cry to you, O Lord. I say, you are my refuge, my portion in the land of the living. Attend to my cry, for I am brought very low. Deliver me from my persecutors, for they are too strong for me. Bring me out of prison that I may give thanks to your name. The righteous will surround me, for you will deal bountifully with me. Let's pray. Lord, we want to thank you that even in the midst of difficulties, even in the midst of being and having that feeling of being imprisoned, you are the one who is there. You are always there. You always were, you are, you ever will be. You are the triune God, Father, Son, and Spirit. And we thank you, Lord God Almighty, that we have the privilege of coming before you today and thanking you, worshiping you, seeking your face, hearing your word, and asking your Spirit to teach us as we live in a world that is becoming increasingly difficult to be a follower of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We thank you for the words that you've given us even in that opening psalm this morning. You are the rock, you are the fortress, you are the deliverer, the refuge, the shield, the strength, the stronghold of your people. And we call upon you because you are worthy to be praised. We want to thank you, God, for help in the last few weeks, especially for those who have faced personal difficulties, maybe still are. Family situations, and still are. Well, thank you for your grace to help in times of need. And we praise you and we do thank you, Lord, for your help for that week of our holiday Bible club, our church outreach. Thank you, Lord. And as David did, O God, we call to you for help. Some here are anxious. Pressures of life, the buffeting storms of every day. We are mortal, and we struggle mentally and emotionally and physically and spiritually from all sorts of things. Lord, we ask for your help, your grace, a reminder of your ultimate purpose, a reminder of heaven itself. And today, O God, we especially think of Norman and Pearl and their family, including the Biddles far away. We pray, O Lord, your grace and help to them, as we do for Ronnie and for Doreen, for Ted and Lila, others who are there, Saunders, Mwinnies, others serving you, Hannah gone off to serve you in England as well. Lord, we do pray for our young people. Pray for those who have been through exams this week or the turmoil of waiting anxiously for news. We pray for them, whatever the results were. We ask that they may know they are not out of the center of your purpose as children of God if their faith is in you, but that they will commit their lives afresh to you. We pray for schools starting back. We pray for teachers, parents, those who help in schools. Lord, bless them, we pray. Thank you for education. We pray for those who need guidance. We pray for all who are making decisions for us, and perhaps some of them we have to make ourselves, which might be difficult. Oh Lord, we pray for our church departments as they consider starting up again. Go before us. Pray for those who are on holiday this weekend. Your blessing upon them. Pray for everyone here. We all need you, Lord. As we think of ourselves, we think of our sister churches around Ireland, and we pray for those, all of them in the association, for our association workers, department leaders, committees. We pray for our association secretary, Dave Ramsey. Bless him, Lord, and his family. And for others outside of Baptist circles who proclaim the same word, the same gospel. We thank you for that. And speaking of your word, O God, we pray that you will speak to us today. We want to praise you. And so we ask simply and sincerely in the words of that modern song, speak, O Lord, as we come to you. Lord, bless your people. And we know that you will. You are the shepherd of our sheep, of the sheep, the flock of God. And we ask in Jesus' name. Well, boys and girls, I know you're here somewhere, and we're not coming to the front today, but hopefully it's going to pick up in a week or two, maybe even next week, I'm not sure, when things will kick back into place in September. But in the meanwhile, I want to tell you something. I want to ask you something first. Have you ever made a mistake? Put your hand up, adults included, if you've made a mistake. Okay? And I'm sure we've all made mistakes. That's great. Do you know, I made a mistake last Sunday morning. Did anybody notice? I'm sure the wee ones may not have noticed, but somebody noticed. Somebody in our house noticed. Where did you learn your science? I said, school. Did you not know there's not zero gravity on the moon? It's a very small percentage of gravity that's on the moon, but I said zero gravity on the moon. Of course, it couldn't be if I thought about it. And boys and girls, the people who were walking on the moon couldn't have walked on the moon if there wasn't some sort of gravity. So if our gravity on Earth is about, let's say, number six, then the gravity on the moon is number one. So it's a little, but it's there enough. So I got that wrong. You know, that reminded me of a story in the Bible of a little girl who realized that her master was in trouble. His name was Naaman, and we don't even know the name of the little girl, but she was one of the key people in that story. And Naaman was very sick and getting worse. And this little girl said to Naaman's wife, you know, if my master went across to the land that I came from, because she was a slave girl, she had been taken from there, if he found a man who is the prophet of God, a man called Elisha, then I know God would help him. Well, the lady said that to her husband, and off he went, the man, and he took a few others with him, and away he went over to that land, and he brought some presents. And you can imagine that he was waiting for Elisha to come out and to meet him. Elisha didn't even bother coming to the door. That's strange. Imagine traveling all those miles, hundreds of miles, to see somebody and they wouldn't even come to the door. They just sent a message. Go and wash yourself in the River Jordan and do it seven times. Well, Naaman made a mistake. He said, what? Seven times in that dirty river, the River Jordan? Back home, we have two tremendous rivers, the Euphrates and the Pharpar, and they are a lot cleaner and a lot better. I could have stayed there and washed. I'm going home. And he was just about to. He was going to make that mistake. And only for his helpers, his servants, said to him, whoa, just slow down there. Do you know if that prophet, I know he didn't come to the door, but if that prophet was going to say, do something great and wonderful or pay a lot of money or walk 100 miles, you would have done it. All he wants you to do is to go and dip in that river, the one he mentioned, the Jordan River, 7 times. Would you not do it? And really, he turned around and acknowledged his mistake by going and doing it. And so he dipped down 6 times. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right under the water and up. No change. He was still ill. He still had a disease called leprosy. 1 more. Down he went and up he came. And his skin was like a newborn baby. Wow, he was healed. But more than that, boys and girls, because he acknowledged his mistake, he actually came to a greater healing. Because even though he didn't know much about the true and living God that we learn about every week, and what a privilege that is, and the Lord Jesus who came later, this man also came to trust in our God, the same God, or rather we've come to trust in his God, the same God, because there is only one God. So it's good to acknowledge your mistakes, because sometimes they lead to better things. We're going to sing a song now, and we're going to be led again by the group, and it's My Lighthouse. I was going to say Cornerstone. My Lighthouse is what we're going to sing. Thanks, guys.
Now, this song does have actions, so I need some help. Come on up, Jake. Jake's already offered. And do you want to come up as well? That'd be great. Does anybody else want to come up and try some actions? Or is it just these two lads? We're going to try as well, but it's kind of difficult with mics, so follow these guys, not us, okay? So let's stand, and let's. I want to see plenty of activity as well as the singing. Come on, let's go.
See, oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea.
Round of applause, please, boys. Thank you.
Thanks, guys. We're going to sing again just in a moment or two, but before that, we want to look at God's Word. Ephesians chapter 1, please. I was trying to think, what do you share at the end of a summer before the autumn work begins? And there was just one passage that kept coming back, and I tried just to look at it in a fresh way, and the Lord opened up a few thoughts. It's really those thoughts I'm just sharing with you this morning, reasons that you can be thankful unto God. And we're going to read Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 1, down to verse 14. And when we come to verse 3, I'm not going to try and read it the way Paul wrote it. I know he wrote in the Greek, but from verse 3, what we have is verse 3 to verse 14. He wrote in one sentence, straight through. We put full stops, commas before that as well. Let's read. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, to the saints who are in Ephesus and are faithful in Christ Jesus, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace, with which he has blessed us in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time, to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, so that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be to the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, we're sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of his glory. Lord, bless your word and bless it as we come to it. Speak to us, enrich us, encourage us, stir us by your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to sing again, Jesus, Thank You, the mystery of the cross.
History of the cross, I cannot come. a perfect sacrifice I've been brought near. Let me have made your friend. Pouring out the riches of your glorious grace, your mercy and your kindness know no end. Your blood has washed away my sin. Jesus, thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Once your enemy, now seated at your table. Jesus, thank you.
That first slide up, please, Shanti. Thank you. What's it all about? All the work we do as Christians, all the work we do through church or outside of that, connected to it. It's all that we can praise Him and give Him honor. Reasons to be thankful. There are several here this morning. And by the way, not only is verses 3 through to 14, one particular sentence when it was originally written. It's a whole feast on the table. It's too much, as it were, for our minds to comprehend all the riches set out there in a large banquet, a large buffet, and we just don't know where to start. A girl called Ruth Paxton called it the Grand Canyon of Scripture. You can imagine that, something, I've never seen the Grand Canyon, but something massively big, wide, and deep that seems to just go on forever. And you can't see it all. And I'm not going to try this morning. But what we're going to do, we're going to do a little drone over. I saw a beautiful picture the other day, and I'm sure you've seen many like it, but it was an unusual one of Carrick Reed Rope Bridge. Normally you see them from the cliff top on the mainland bit, or you see it looking across the bridge or coming the other way, or from the little fisherman's house up, or from the middle bit up. But this one was right on top of it. And someone had posted, a friend that I know, underneath and said, "I hope your head stops spinning, because you could easily just whoa." But we know what drones can do, and they're wonderful things when they're used properly. And we're going to drone over this here, and I hope I don't drone you. But as we do this, we're just going to pull out some things that we can take home with us, take away with us, and study ourselves, and just keep bringing back to the Lord and saying, "Thank you, Lord. Thank you for all that you have done." So let's look at some of those things. Thanks, John. Whenever this letter was written in Ephesians, the first part is very doctrinal and rich with doctrine. The second part opens out and it goes into, okay, how to live this out. And it was a difficult time for the Ephesian church. In one sense, they were a strong church. In another sense, they became very weak. If you read their story in Revelation, the first couple of chapters, or 2 to 3, you'll find there that they lost their first love. Now, that's not speaking about they lost the love of singing or they lost the love of meeting together. It's talking about Jesus. They were doing so much, but they forgot about Jesus. They forgot to come back to things like this and just focus their thoughts on God. And if it happens to them and could happen to them, it can happen to any one of us or any church. And sorry if you can't see it, I'm a wee bit far away. But the first one is all about we praise because he is worthy of that. He's worthy. Look at verse 1, first of all. And we're going to say, scan over. We praise God. And how many times in this portion do we find those words? Blessed. Lord, may honor be given to you. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us. So the focus is immediately sent to God. Sometimes our worship is focused on ourselves or even on the church. All spiritual focus has to be firstly and foremostly to the Lord. So we go verse 1, we go verse 6, or verse 3 rather, verse 6. And we see all these things to the praise of his glorious grace. Verse 12, similar. To the praise of his glory. And the same phrase right at the bottom in verse 14, to the praise of his glory. Paul can't get away and doesn't want to get away and wants these people to know that they are there on earth primarily to worship God. I grew up in the Presbyterian church and they taught me many wonderful things. And one of them was that the number one in the shorter catechism, what is man's chief end? Some of you will know this. Man's chief end is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. To glorify God. Man's chief end. Boys and girls, that means what is the most important thing in life? It's to bring glory to the God who made you. The glory to the God who made us. And that's why we've themed this in praise, because Paul does exactly the same at that point. The second one down, he has blessed us. Look at verse 3. He has blessed us. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. We haven't blessed ourselves. The world hasn't blessed us, although the Lord does help us in certain ways and certain things. But the true blessings that are from heaven are the blessings that come from him. And that's why they're, in one sense, heavenly blessings. But we'll come back to that in a little later on. But truly, we are the blessed of God. Here are just some of them that I've written down. We've got purpose in life. We've got meaning. We have got peace. We have got joy. We have got the presence of God. We've got guidance. We've got friendship. We have got heaven. We've got Christians around us to help us on that journey. We mentioned David a few times already this morning, and David records for us in Psalm 94, verse 19, when the cares of my heart are many, your consolations cheer my soul. And of course, we've got, as I mentioned there, heaven itself. Remember the two thieves, if you were out last Sunday evening? We looked at on the crosses, Jesus on the center cross. And the greatest blessing that one of them was going to have that day was to be in paradise with the Lord forever. No more physical pain, no more emotional pain, no more relational pain, no more financial pain, no more guilt of pain, nothing. All gone. And the Lord is the one who pours these things out upon us. And so we praise him. The next one, he has rescued us. I've already alluded to these. Some of these do cross over, but look at verse 7. He's rescued us in him, in Jesus. We have redemption through his blood the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace. That's where the praise goes back to God again, because of what he has done for us. And the word here is taken from the Old Testament story of Moses leading the people across the Red Sea, out of Egypt, Exodus. And before they went, there was a special commandment that was given to them. Paint the doorposts of your home and the cross section called the lintel with the blood of a sacrifice. And the Lord said to Moses, when I see that blood, I will pass over. I will not bring trauma to your household because you are coming on a journey with me. And all God's people were protected, and they were rescued, and they were brought out. They were redeemed, brought out of slavery, bought out of slavery, and eventually to become a great people in the land where they still are, many of them, today. And when you come into the New Testament, you find the same thing opening up, because it has been. This is always the plan. It wasn't about finding a new place to live on the earth, ultimately. It was ultimately about finding our place in Christ Jesus, that we would be safe. And that's why in a little while we'll come around the table and we will take bread that will remind us that Jesus came to this earth in a human form, and he was nailed to the cross and his body was ripped apart for us. And we will take wine to show us that he died, his life blood was shed. God the Father accepted that as the one supreme, never to be repeated sacrifice for our wrongs, for the wrongs of these people in Ephesus and every believer in Christ Jesus throughout the history of time. We can say we are redeemed in the beloved, in Christ, and we have redemption through that blood, and our sins, which are many, as the hymn writer says, are forgiven. When we come to the table, we are simply thanking God. Lord, I praise you, Jesus, that you died for me. Another reason we can thank the Lord and praise him is because that we have been adopted. Look at verses 5 and verse 13. In verse 5, we read these words: he predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will. And then down in 13, in him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit. The plan of God that began even before that first word was spoken, when it says in the beginning God created, before that, God was, always was. And somewhere there in eternity past, we'll call it, the Lord had a, and I say it carefully, a reverent meeting. The Father, the Son, and the Spirit came together. And they covenanted with each other that they would, even though they were one God, they were three persons, and they would accomplish something in the future, for us to understand, in the future, that could never be repeated. The rescue plan was set in place before the rescue plan was needed. Because when God created and man was placed in, man fell away from God and needed to be rescued. And God already had that plan in place. And one aspect of that plan was that he was bringing people into his family. He was adopting them into his family. It's a tremendous thing for people to be involved in adopting those who don't have parents, or the parental situation is beyond hope. And we rejoice with that, and we pray for folks like that. It's a tremendous opportunity for both the child and the adopted parents, or adoptive parents. How much more wonderful is it that our God brings us into his family and actually makes us joint heirs with Jesus? Doesn't mean we're equal with Jesus in every way. We can never be. but we are his brothers. He said so himself. We are in his family. And we are joint heirs of heaven with Jesus. A reason to thank the Lord. Thank you, God, that I am in your family. And that forever. Another one, because God is present with us. Look at verses again, 13, and then we're moving into 14. The gospel has come to us, and him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of his glory. When we heard the gospel, we were brought into that relationship where we were forgiven and we were received. But in that time, God was working in our lives. And the Spirit of God was starting to stir maybe circumstances out there that weren't going the way I wanted them to go or you wanted them to go. And we were brought to a point where we focused our thoughts on God. Somewhere in the background, somewhere behind a fog, God. Or it might have been just a little verse that was plaguing us, or something we were taught as children in Sunday school or by parents, something we heard just that week or just that day or just that night. And it was a message we'd never really heard before like that. It was as if this message was coming newly to us. What was going on? What was happening? God was opening our minds. God was opening our heart. And the Spirit of God, who was already in us, was bringing us to birth that we might be called the children of God. Is that something to be thankful for? You can go to any other religion on the planet. You will never find truth like that. It's always us trying to reach God. It's always a bit of me or most of me or all of me. When you come to the Christian gospel, it's none of me. It's all of God. And he works within us and he brings us to faith in his Son. And he adopts us into his family and he stays there. Isn't that wonderful? God's Holy Spirit is described in his word as the seal. The secure seal that will not be reversed. A few weeks ago, we had the privilege of walking around the beautiful gardens in Hillsborough and into the house as well. We thought we'd do the whole 9 miles, whatever it is, and then we went. And I knew there was a seal connected to Hillsborough, but I never thought of it more than just something that Her Majesty had put out and said, and the little town of Hillsborough, the little village of Hillsborough, will now be a royal borough, a royal town, royal village. I never thought there was actually going to be something written, but of course there had to be. So when I heard that there was the seal was actually in the castle, I imagined this A4 sheet, probably at best an A3, and some sort of waxed seal on it. Now, I don't want to spoil it if you've never been there, but you want to go and you want to see that seal. It's different. It's special. Again, the words we can use, how much more? How much greater is the seal that the God who made the heavens and the earth, the God who puts kings and queens in place, the God who is in sovereign control of the whole of the universe with all the galaxies and everything should come and dwell in me. Wow. And I don't know how he does it, but he dwells in you as well if you're a Christian. And he dwelt in the forefathers before us and those yet to come unless the Lord comes back before them. And he seals us, which is a guarantee of our inheritance. What is that inheritance? Being the heirs of God and the heirs of Christ, joint heirs, and receiving heaven itself. That inheritance that is ours, everything to do with perfection. And you can start to imagine every area of life. That would be an exercise, wouldn't it? Look into every area of life that we're involved in and say, it's imperfect. No matter how good it is at the time, it's always imperfect. And then put perfection on. And you get a glimpse of heaven. And we are sealed onto that day of redemption. He is present with us, a reason to praise. He has a purpose for us. Look at verse 4. That purpose, we are told, is that we would be holy and blameless before him. Whenever someone becomes a Christian and that spirit works in us and we come to faith and we come into God's family and we are forgiven, it's not just a stopping point. It's not like a train stopping at a station and says, look, we're not going any further than this here. You're at the station, you've arrived, we're not going any further. But there's so much more to go. No, this is it. The Christian journey only begins when we come to faith, because the Spirit of God wants to make us, work in us, by his word, by his work, to become like Jesus. So there's a growth part that one day will take us into that threshold of heaven itself, and we will be perfect. But the Christian life is all about growing. And as I said earlier to the boys and girls, I made a mistake. We all make mistakes every day, because we're not perfect. We also are imperfect. In fact, the Bible says we're groaning for that one day when we'll be perfect. But God still works with us, doesn't cast us off, doesn't say, well, hold on a minute, that sin that you were involved in is a bit too big for me to handle. And that thing that keeps coming back into your head that I forgive is just, that's showing me that you're not even right with me. When we sincerely come back to the Lord and genuinely call upon him and ask him to forgive us afresh because we are so wretched, is a word that Paul uses, the Lord's grace just keeps coming. And no matter how much sin is there, as long as we're not doing it and just coming back to God and expecting it, that doesn't work. When we're truly sorry, when we're truly remorseful, as we said last Sunday evening explained it, we find that we are right where God wants us. He just showers us with more grace. Look at the cross. My son took those sins. He died for you. Jesus says, I died for you, to the Father, as he intercedes on our behalf. But God wants us on that journey of blameless. I think it was John Wesley, may have been someone else, but I think it was John Wesley, maybe Charles Wesley, who said when they got to their last day on this earth of sin, they wanted the change into heaven to be so slight that they mightn't even notice it. I'm paraphrasing that. And they weren't saying that heaven was going to be just a better form of earth. They were saying they wanted to walk with God so closely in this life that when it came to the end, they would be like Christ in so many ways. Not to tell others about it, just to be in that place with the Lord. And then just to walk into his presence with him. We are to be holy and blameless before him in love. He has a purpose for us, and he has a plan for everything. Look at verse 10. According to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ, verse 9, as a plan for the fullness of time, to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. It's one of those little lines you could just gloss over, and yet it's the ultimate in everything. It's heaven's perfection. That everything will be complete, everything will be perfect, everything will be brought together. And God has a time fixed on his calendar, we're not privy to it, when that's going to happen. When all of time will cease as we know it, and all of eternity will begin in a way we yet don't know. But we have an inkling of it. We have a glimpse of it. We have a sighting of it. And God's plan is working. Remember the God we spoke of, same God, who way in eternity past, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit came together in that one family, and they declared what they would do, what they would be, and time came, and things opened up in our Old Testament period, right into the New Testament. Standing at the center of all of that is the cross, where Jesus was nailed and paid our price. Then he rose again from the dead, and the tomb was empty, and he ascended into heaven, and on went the church, the body of believers, sharing and telling the story of the wonder of God's time plan. And right at the end, that will never end, is this place called heaven and perfection itself. And all the injustices of this life and this world, things that you're thinking about now, well, if I could have sorted that guy out, I would have done that. I should have done that. Or the more major injustices in the world involve a lot of people, a lot of nations, a lot of sorrow, all sorted. Reasons to praise? Can we go to the last slide, John, just as we close? I want to just share a moment about that phrase, heavenly places. What does that mean? When you go there and you find those words, God has blessed us in Christ Jesus with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. That simply means that whenever we become believers, all of these things that we've been talking about coming from heaven start to influence strongly our mindset. So every blessing that God gives to us, whatever it is, has a heavenly side to it that I can't see as a non-Christian. I can't see as someone who has yet not yielded to say sorry to the Lord Jesus, to acknowledge that the death that he died on the cross was for me, and the life he lived was for me, and his resurrection raises me from the dead. Someone who hasn't been there. So if you're not a Christian in that sense of trusting in the Lord for yourself, only Christ, then these things will not be understood entirely. You may hear them, you may register them, but you can't know them. You can't know them. But for those of us who are, and that's why I've written that word, is this mine? It's a good test to go back if you're not a Christian and say, that peace, that joy, that hope of heaven, that forgiveness of sins, that adoption into God's family, is that not because I attended a church or went to some meeting or was friendly with Christians or had Christian heritage in my family and have a Bible at home? No. It's through that personal relationship with the Lord Jesus. One of the verses, probably the, that means the history of time, words have been written. Praise. Our intent, this earth will never ultimately fill everything, and we recognize that because we're above walking with God. Our relationships will have spiritual direction. The gospel will become vital in our prayers for our family and our communities and those around us, and we will proclaim it. Life from birth, through the growing, through the fading, right through death, everything is filtered through the Word of God, filtered through God's plan and God's story. And everything is all about Christ and only about Christ. That's not something we just sort of tune into and say, that sounds like a good idea. It's the story of a child of God and how we read the world, how we live in the world, how we exist in the world, how we cope with the world. Think about that. If we bring that into our own world, we can only do it because of the giftings of God from the heavenly places, enabling us to see heavenly aspects. Just as we close, I remember one of the, I know I didn't do much science at school or probably didn't listen, but I certainly remember probably the simplest experiment that I have ever seen in science. Even I can get this. A prism, a triangular block of glass, sort of like a bit like a Toblerone. You know what it is. And a light is shone through it. and that bends the light. It's called refraction. And out of that comes a spectrum of color. It's one of the things I remember. When the light of God shines into our lives and bends and breaks in all directions, then we find that every area of life, red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet, all the colors of my life are filled with Christ, and I see things from that heavenly perspective. Reasons to be thankful. It's not very hard to find them. In this grand canyon that Paul gives to us in these verses, let's take those thoughts, take them home, and say, thank you, Lord, for that. Thank you, Lord, for that. Praise you, God, for that. And as the keynote of the Reformation, sola Deo gloria, to God alone be the glory, we say that. We're going to sing one of those songs that I mentioned there. My heart is filled with thankfulness. And then we're going straight into our Lord's table by way of practically and spiritually saying, thank you, Lord, for what you have done for us. Thanks, guys. Just pray together. Lord, we want to thank you that you've given us so much and you give us so much, and there's so much more yet to come. And all of these things, oh God, are secured for us by the death of your Son, Jesus, our Savior, our surety, our substitute on the cross. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for being willing to come and die for us, die for me. Thank you for bearing all our sin, for bearing my sin. Thank you for rising from the dead to declare us just to declare me just. And Lord, as we come together this morning to take bread and wine, we want to focus our thoughts on the greatest act of history ever accomplished. Your death for us. Lord, we simply say, thank you. And we also want to ask, Lord, that you'd help us to live lives that are holy unto you, blameless before you. And yet if we do sin, we know that we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ himself, the righteous. We also know that his death covers all of our sin. And we thank you, Lord. May we walk with the Spirit, not grieve him, but rejoice in our God. Rejoice in you, the Lord of our salvation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, again, we just want to say thank you. We have so many reasons to be thankful. And we want to as well ask for your help to grow in grace so we can be more thankful. And so we pray with your servant Paul that the grace, or that the God of hope, will fill us with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit we may abound in hope. In Jesus' name we ask, and we pray, and we praise. Amen.